Hello, welcome online, all those that are joining us online. Every week, just for those who are in person, every week we have around 200 people that join us online for worship. And I'm really excited that God is using what's happening here in person, and it's going all around our community and all around the world. We keep hearing stories of what God is doing through our live stream. So again, welcome. You're very much a part of what God is doing. We encourage you, even as you're watching right now, go ahead and maybe share the message on your social media, or even go ahead and actually hit somebody up, text them, and be like, hey, you got to check out what God's doing here. Join me for church this morning. All right. Hey, real quick, if you are in person, you can give at our boxes and back. Also, we do have online giving. We have a lot of information and resources on our website at clfonline.org. All right. And this is our week 3 of Kingdom Culture. Here you go.
Boom! I did it. Canceled. That was tough. Can't touch this. But I did it. Can't
touch this. Yo!
Hey, what's up?
How you doing? How are you guys? How are
what's
you?
Up?
Bridge, how are you doing?
Good. So what are we up to?
I just did it. I canceled it.
No, what? You didn't.
Yeah.
Yes, yeah, let's go.
Dude, no
let's
way. Go. I could never do that. I don't know how you did it.
You mean you haven't canceled?
Whoa. Next topic. What do you guys want for dinner?
Oh, pizza for sure. Been craving some pineapple pizza.
Dude, not cool. Not cool? Not cool at all.
What?
Not cool at all? Hashtag Pizzagate.
And pineapple on pizza? Bro, you need Jesus. Pizza is canceled.
Okay, fine. What do you guys want to eat then?
I could go for some sushi. I'm really craving a citrus salmon roll.
No, no way we're getting sushi. Have you heard about that new sushi place? I heard they skin the fish alive. Think about what that poor salmon went through. No way.
For real?
No, sushi is canceled.
How about La Taquiera? I haven't heard anything bad about them yet.
Nothing bad about them?
No.
How could you betray our first love, El Mezcal?
Easy.
They've been with us through thick and thin, and you're gonna choose some flashy new Mexican place?
Yep.
No. La Taquiera is canceled.
Yeah, Ben, canceled. Have some respect.
Respect? I do have respect. Have you had their fish tacos?
Dude.
Unbelievable.
We just talked about fish. We're not getting fish. Think about what that fish went through. Fish is canceled. Dude, I'm starting to think that you don't care about anything. You canceled your subscription. That was brave. But now I'm thinking maybe you just did that because everybody else is.
That is not true. Do you remember when I found out how oppressive potato farming is? They're shoved underground, and then once they're ready, they're violently ripped from their homes. All for what? McDonald's?
I had no idea the issues surrounding potatoes. Such a horrific, destructive industry. I just feel so disgusted with myself supporting them. Potatoes are canceled. I need to go repent.
We all need to repent from our oppressive eating habits. Enough of this. Let's go with Old Faithful. Staple of integrity. The one who never let us down. The one who's always been there. Culver's.
No. Ben, Culver's is canceled.
What? Why?
It's the cheese curds.
No. Not the cheese curds.
Yes. Tell.
You know the milk from the cheese curds is not locally sourced. We're in Wisconsin, and it comes from California. That's all the way across the country, so you're pretty much eating your cheese curds from China. Your cheese curds are from China.
Who did this? Why?
Curds are canceled, y'all. They are. That's how it is now. Curds are canceled. Curds are canceled. Curds are canceled.
Curds are canceled.
I can't do it. Not the curds. Anything but the curds.
Not the curds.
Not the curds. I can't. Anything but the curds.
I can't. I can't do it. I can't cancel the curds.
You can't touch this.
I think that's hilarious. Listen, we are in interesting times, and if we can't laugh about it, then I don't know what in the world we're going to do. So hopefully you can get a good chuckle at that or something along those lines. Let's not take ourselves too seriously in this time. Hey, I want to just say, too, if you're If you're back, if you've been here over the last couple weeks or you've been streaming the last couple weeks and you tuned back in or you came back into the building, I just want to say, look at this, guys. We've had this. It's not been easy weeks. I know the things that I've been saying haven't been easy to hear, and that's okay. And I'm just impressed that people are still tuning in. People are still coming. You guys are awesome. I love you. And what a privilege it is to press into God's word and to figure out what it is that he wants to say to us and how he wants us living during this time. We live in an extraordinary time, and I believe God wants to do some great stuff in us and through us. So we're in this series, Kingdom Culture. And the main verse that we've been using is this idea that Jesus laid out really clearly. He said in John 18:36 that my kingdom is not an earthly kingdom. If it were, my followers would fight to keep me from being handed over to the Jewish leaders, but my kingdom is not of this world. And we've been talking about the fact that the world around us at Jesus' time and ever since then has been trying to press Jesus into a mold, trying to make him fit structures that make sense, and Jesus isn't having any of it. Jesus came to play a totally different game than the rest of the world, and he doesn't fit into red parties or blue parties. He doesn't fit into the structures of this world. He said it very clearly that his kingdom is transcendent of this world. It's different. Now, it doesn't mean that you and I are like somehow transported and we don't live in reality and we just like get out of the reality of this world. We live in the reality of this world, but at the same time we're living in the reality of this world. God's calling us to be ambassadors of his kingdom, of a different way, of different values, things that are not of this world. And so we talked last week, if that's the case, that means that a lot of times if Jesus is playing a different game and we're called to follow him in that, it doesn't fit into our categories. The kingdom of God, the way of Jesus, it doesn't fit into things that make sense. When we try to press him into molds that do make sense, that work for our brains, and one of the main ones that we get stuck in, especially in this season, is politics. We try to equate Jesus with a particular political party or a particular political movement or a particular nation or type of ruling, and the bottom line is he doesn't fit into those things, and we have to get comfortable as followers of Jesus in the tension that creates, because it creates tension. Being in the world, but not of the world, not like the rest of the world, that creates tension. Like, if we're being honest, I hope that you never feel like I'm up here just sort of spitting out, you know, Christian bumper sticker slogans and without just acknowledging this is tough stuff. Like, it's not easy for us to figure out how to follow Jesus in the times that we're in, and yet we're called to do that, every single one of us. God calls us to do that. So this morning I want to dig into, the title for this morning is Kingdom Politics. And we're not going to dig into Democrats and Republicans, we're not going to dig into the American political system, politics in that way, but I want to actually get to the root of that word, politics. So where that comes, it's a Greek word at the root of it, and the Greek word is polis, and that means city-state, or it means community structure. So it's basically any gathering of people, any collection of people. It's, we get that, right? Like a population of people that live in a particular area or live a particular way. And then from that, it's the same root that we get politics from. And that just means, politics just means, it's at the root of it is that polis, that city-state community structure. It's the affairs of the city. So when we think about it that way, kingdom politics doesn't mean that we figure out how the kingdom of God fits into the politics of the United States. It means that we figure out what is the politic, what is the governance, what are the affairs of the city of God, what are the affairs of the kingdom of God, what does that look like? And then how do we import that, how do we bring that to bear on the world around us? So the church is already political. That's the bottom line. And again, I don't mean advocating for one party or advocating for the other. I think that's where we've gotten ourselves into trouble, is that we have fallen into the trap of advocating for earthly kingdoms and earthly politics. We're already political in and of ourselves, our DNA, who we are as followers of Jesus, in the truest sense of the word, political. The differentiating factor for us is that our polis, the kingdom of God, right? That's our community. That's our city-state. Like, we are citizens of the United States, and we live in Port Edwards and Nakusa and Wisconsin Rapids or wherever you hail from. We're a part of those communities. But priority for us, our citizenship is in the kingdom of God, number one. And that trumps and goes before everything else. In our, I didn't say Trump on purpose, I promise. That, but it does, it trumps, it supersedes all of our other political allegiances. It's first and foremost a kingdom politic. So our polis is of a higher realm. So when a, I mean, think about this. When a Christian confesses that Jesus is Lord, that there is a Lord who is an author of all history, and he's a Lord over the universe, that his name is Jesus, that Christian, we're practicing politics. That's the reality of it. We're talking about a kingdom, and we're talking about the affairs of that kingdom. We transcend our earthly politics when we declare, along with Isaiah, it talks about this in Isaiah chapter 40, that all of the nations of the earth, all of them are a drop in the bucket, that all of them amount to dust on a scale. And Jesus is king, and the nations one day, all the nations are going to be brought to nothing, and it's going to be the kingdom of God that reigns supreme. Like, that's a political statement. And I don't mean it's a political commentary on the United States or on any other nation. I'm saying it's talking about a polis. It's talking about a city-state, a community of people. It's talking about the affairs of the kingdom of God. And that's what I want to talk to you about this morning, okay? So I want to balance this real quick, because here's the deal. We've been saying this, like, kingdom culture, all this idea, it doesn't mean that we are somehow divorced from reality, that God wants us, like, detached, and he just wants us to be in a commune out in the woods, and we just, like, the world can go to hell, we're going to do our thing and follow Jesus, and this is a different kingdom. Like, that's ridiculous. That's not the way of Jesus either, okay? Now, what I'm saying may sort of feel like I'm saying that this world doesn't matter and these systems don't matter. Here's the deal. Here's how I'd explain that. We talked last week about the fact that the kingdom of God doesn't fit into our categories, but we try to make it fit. And that instead we need to get comfortable sitting in tension with two truths that feel like they are mutually exclusive. So, and we need to learn to be okay in the tension of the both and, instead of getting stuck in the either or. So we talked about, like, God is... he is sovereign over everything. That's true, and it says that in Scripture. But at the same time, we're told that human beings have free will. Those feel like mutually exclusive claims on truth. And yet, as Christ followers, we're called to learn to sit in the tension of that and not choose either or, but to choose both and to figure out, how do we make that work then? That God's sovereign over everything, but at the same time, human beings have free will, right? We're like, God calls us to a standard of holiness, a standard of, I mean, and it is a high standard, but at the same time, there's grace in everything. So those seem like two competing, they're mutually exclusive claims, but they're not according to Scripture. We have to figure out, how do we live in the both and not the either or. And so I would say the same thing as it pertains to this. We're not saying that the kingdom culture means that we just no longer exist in this world. We don't care about what happens in this country. We don't care about how, like, God doesn't care how we vote, or he doesn't care about what laws are passed, or all of those things. But I really believe with all my heart that we've fallen into the trap as the church of making things that are not meant to be first, we've made them first. We've made them a bigger deal than they are supposed to be. And so this whole series feels like it's pushing all one direction. Like it's pushing, like, politics, like earthly politics don't matter and none of this stuff matters. And I'm saying to you, that is because I'm feeling the need to bring correction from the way that we have leaned and the way that we have strayed. It doesn't mean that we're not a part of political process. We're not a part of engaging in our communities. As you'll see this morning, it's actually quite the opposite of that. So what we end up with is this understanding that we need to have, that God, the way that he works, the way that he accomplishes his work of bringing the kingdom of God to bear, the way he accomplishes his work is by forming a people. Always, that's how he does it. So when God started his work in creation, and we're actually going to unpack this after this series is done. We're going to get into Scripture. We're going to look at the narrative of all of Scripture from the beginning to the end to see the story of the kingdom of God. I'm really excited about it. But even when God created the earth, okay, when he created humanity, he creates Adam and Eve, and he sets them in charge of his affairs. He put them in the garden, set them in charge of it, told them to rule over the earth, and basically said, like, our calling as human beings is to reflect the image of God to the world around us. And it's to gather up the praise of creation around us and to bring it back to God. When God seeks to do something, the way he carries it out is by creating for himself a people that will carry out his work, okay? And then when Adam and Eve screwed it up and they fell into sin, God did the exact same thing with Abraham. He called him and said, I'm going to make you the father of many nations. Like, I'm going to create for myself a people who are going to, they're going to be my ambassadors on earth. And then when the Israelites screwed it up, then Jesus came as the perfect example, as a perfect representative of the nation of Israel, expanded that work to anyone who would believe in him as Lord and as Savior. And now the church, you and I, followers of Jesus, we are the ambassadors of the kingdom of God. And this is how God chooses to do his work, is through his people. It's not, listen, God chooses to do his work by forming a people, and almost always the way he chooses to do his work is subversive, which means it doesn't fit into the power structures that are in existence in the world around us. It's transcendent of those. It's outside of it. And now it's brought to bear into the world that we find ourselves in. So in this world, all since the beginning of time, all different civilizations from ancient all the way until now, all different belief systems, put it in a box. And it's all these human ways of trying to approach God, or human ways of trying to have community, or trying to rule the earth and subdue it. Like, do these kinds of things, right? Fit it all into this box. And God comes along and he forms for himself a people that exist in this box, but they don't function the way that this box functions. We are called to be transcendent, speaking into the ways of the culture. And to do that, God rarely uses the power systems. God rarely uses the structures that are in existence to carry out his purposes. It doesn't mean that he never does, but he rarely does. In fact, most of the time when you look back on church history, when the church has lost its way, it's because the church got messed up and started thinking that the way God was going to accomplish bringing his kingdom to bear was going to be by using power structures within the world that already exists. And so if we can just get the right person elected, get the right legislation passed, have the right governmental system, then the kingdom of God can flourish. And that's usually when the church gets off track. We have to understand that God is subverting the power structures of this world by putting something else completely different on display. Completely different. It's not backing his followers and his people out of the world so they're not a part of it. It's very different. It's forming us in the ways that are not of this world while we live in this world, so that the difference between the ways of God and the ways of this world are brought into sharp contrast and sharp relief with one another. And the world sees that there is a way other than what we lean towards as human beings, okay? So this is the kingdom politic that we're talking about. So Jesus comes along and he says this, Matthew 13:33. He was always doing this. He was always using them, we call them parables, stories or different object lessons, because you're trying to explain something that's otherworldly, but in terms that we can understand in our world, right? So Jesus says this. He told them still another parable. The kingdom of heaven, that's the kingdom of God, is like yeast that a woman took and mixed into about 60 pounds of flour until it worked all through the dough. Okay, so Jesus was always using stuff that was like, you're trying to explain the unexplainable in a lot of ways. And so he was like, the kingdom of God is like a seed that a farmer takes and he buries it in the ground, and then it sprouts roots and it's watered and then it bears fruit. The kingdom of God is like this, the kingdom of God is like that. And in this particular instance, he says, the kingdom of God is like 60 pounds of flour. This is 60 pounds of flour, okay? And he says, the kingdom of God is actually like yeast that is a woman works its way through all the dough in 60 pounds of flour so that it can produce bread, so that it can have its effect on the bread around it. So I'm not a baker. I've never played one on TV. It's not me. Okay, I like to eat baked goods. I don't know how to bake. In general, you don't want me around the kitchen. That might be strategic on my part, that I'm like, oh, I would screw it up if I tried. So somebody else should just, make the food. But I did a little bit of research because I don't know these things. For 60 pounds of flour, you need roughly 1 cup of yeast. That's how much this is. This is like the ratio of flour to yeast. This is a ton of flour. Do you know how much bread we could make with this? Incidentally, if you want to take some flour home after service, you can have at it, okay? Or some yeast. The ratio of yeast to flour is very, very small. It's seemingly insignificant. And if you know anything about baking, which again, I don't know a ton, but I know enough, I know that not putting yeast in bread makes it basically like cardboard. It makes a cracker. And it doesn't rise and make amazing, beautiful dough that is like hot, steaming bread where you cut into it and then you slather some butter on it while it's still hot. So good. Like, and everybody that doesn't eat carbs right now hates me that I'm even describing this. Like, this is torture because it's delicious, right? So yeast is what causes the dough to rise. And if you know anything about it, you know that you have to mix the right amount of yeast in with the dough, with the flour, and it has to be mixed in thoroughly. That's why Jesus said the kingdom of heaven is like yeast that a woman took and mixed into about 60 pounds of flour until it worked all through the dough. You got to get that yeast into every nook and cranny. It's coming in contact with everything. And then another thing I know about yeast working on dough is that it's slow. Like, you got to wait for the dough to rise. That's the bottom line. If you are impatient, you're going to put your bread in too soon and you're going to end up with a cracker instead of a loaf of bread. And that's the way that it's going to go if you don't give time for the yeast to do its work. And so Jesus comes along and he says, listen, this is the kingdom of God. The kingdom of God is like yeast. The kingdom of God needs to be worked into every facet of the culture around it. God's desire is to bring the values, the politics, the matters of the city of God, the matters of the kingdom of God, to bear on the world around us, all over the world. And the way he chooses to do that, we're told, is through you and through me, that we are Christ's ambassadors, that it's actually, when you choose to follow Jesus, it's no longer you that lives, it's Christ that lives inside of you. So everywhere you go, every conversation that you have, the scriptures say you are bringing the fragrance of Christ with you wherever you go, that you are bringing the character and the nature, the politics of the kingdom of God to bear in your neighborhood and in your families and in your workplaces. And here's the deal, it is a slow work. It takes time for yeast to, I think what yeast actually does, I believe, that it actually catalyzes the sugar that's in the dough, and there's a chemical reaction, that's what causes the rising of the dough. That takes time. And we get ourselves into trouble when we desperately want to see the kingdom of God all over the world, right? Like, we know the kingdom of God is not about arbitrary rule following. The kingdom of God is about, it is about human flourishing. God created human beings in his image. He knows what's best for us. And so, like, as followers of Jesus, we want to see his ways and his purposes prevail because that's what's best for all of humanity, right? God owns the blueprint on all of this. It was all his idea. But we get ourselves into trouble and we go like, man, if the whole world would just see how we saw and if the whole world would just live the way that Jesus wants us to live, then everything would be better. And then if we are so motivated to see that happen that we actually short-circuit the process that God has put in place to bring that about. And we go, if we can just get into power and to do these things, then we can make that happen. And what you end up with is like a hollow, fake version of the real thing. You can't skip the process when you mix yeast with dough and you allow it to rise and then you bake the bread. There is a process and it takes time. You can't skip or you can't throw it in the microwave because we want it quicker. That's not the way that it works. It takes time. And if we, going back to our, like, the box of all the world's ways, and we're supposed to be outside of that, acting in on it, but we represent a different way of doing things. When we allow ourselves to get pressed into the political means, or we get pressed into the means of power structures and all of those things in the world around us, we end up with, like the faux leather version of Jesus. It's like, if you just glance at it, it looks enough like Jesus that you're like, yeah, that's kind of like Jesus. But then it doesn't take a whole lot to realize, yeah, but that's not real leather. That's not authentic. That's not the real thing. And if I can just submit to you what's going on in our culture right now, in the church, in our nation, there is a whole lot of pressure being exerted on the church, and there are a lot of ways that as followers of Jesus, we're failing. And it's being shown for what it is, that we have put our hope in things that we were not supposed to put our hope in. We have tied ourselves to practices and ways of existence that are, we're not to tie ourselves to those things. That is not the way that the kingdom of God moves. It's not the way that God functions. And all this pressure is being exerted, and it's like we're being shown for what's, it's like faux Christianity. It's kind of like it, but it's not. It's missing the key ingredients. It's missing the key qualities and the key textures that actually make us Christ-like. So Jesus lays it out there. The kingdom of God, you could say, is a patient ferment. That it is this, it's a patient fermentation process, and it takes time, and it can feel maddeningly slow, but over history, when the people of God have engaged in that patient ferment instead of exchanging it for something that feels more expedient and it feels like we're getting more traction, when the people of God have stuck with the ways of God and we've allowed ourselves like yeast to be kneaded into the dough of the culture around us, there is transformation that actually has happened. So if you go back, I'm going to use just a couple of examples. There's a lot of these examples, but it's this idea of Christianity subverting the culture and replacing the values of the culture with the values of the kingdom of God slowly over time, not by a power grab, but by living out an empowered and powerful life through Jesus Christ, right? So here's a couple of examples. One of the best examples is slavery. Now, back in the day, in ancient times, this is sort of hard to believe. Nobody would have ever argued that slavery was wrong. Nobody. Slavery was just a fact of existence. There was slavery all over the place. Now, I will distinguish, it didn't look anything like, and for the most part, it didn't look like the chattel slavery of the United States earlier on in our history, okay? But nobody would have argued against it. Because it was, here's what Aristotle said. So Aristotle, ancient philosopher, we have philosophers to try to help us make sense of the world. I mean, that's basically what's happening. And you're talking a few thousand years ago, Aristotle said this. For that some should rule and others be ruled is a thing not only necessary but expedient. From the hour of their birth, some are marked out for subjection, others for rule. He's like, there's not even a moral argument to it. He's just saying this is just what it is, and it's actually for the best of everybody that it is. This is the way that people thought. Okay, now again, we have to make a distinction. Slavery in ancient times, for the most part, wasn't what we think of when we think of slavery. Slavery was, it had nothing to do with race. It wasn't one race being subjugated by another race, which is what happened in the United States. It was basically like anybody could potentially be anybody's slave. So you missed your payment on your house or your horse, whatever, okay? And they would come for you and they would come for your son too. And you would both go into indentured servitude and you would work off the debt that you owed. You would be a slave to somebody else. Sometimes it had to do if one nation conquered another nation and then they'd be taken, you know, the conquered nation would be taken captive and taken into slavery. But many times it was an economics thing and it had to do with money. Okay? And so Aristotle's like, this is just a thing. And then what you have in the people of God is you see echoes of it, or you see, rumblings of it in the Old Testament with the Jewish people, the way that, again, God was setting apart a people for himself, and he was very clear with how people were supposed to be treated and what servanthood was supposed to look like. And then you get to the people of God through Jesus, and it's like everything is brought into sharp relief. And you have followers of Jesus who are going like, yet slavery doesn't square with the testimony of scriptures about who human beings are. That if human beings are created in the image of God, they're like, we shouldn't be subject to other human beings. That's not the way that it should work. And so early on in the church, you had people beginning to speak out against what was like now we look at it and like we should look at slavery in the United States and be like, what in the world? Like, what in the world? How in the world did people think that? Like, that's so backwards and it's so crazy, right? We should be thinking that. Earlier on, even in the church, you have people start like, this wasn't the case. Everybody just assumed this was a thing. And you had leaders in the church who started going, yet this isn't a thing. This should not be a thing. It's not the way that human beings are created to function. And so you have Augustine, St. Augustine, who was a bishop in the 4th century. You had people before him, but he was probably the most noteworthy. So this is a couple of hundred years into Christianity. He started saying, "This is slavery is a product of sin. This isn't just the way things are and the way that it should be. It's a product of sin, and it shouldn't be. We shouldn't be giving into that." And ever since then, there's been this march towards freedom and towards liberty. For the most part from the church, I would say, except for in rare instances like in the United States, when slavery was actually being, like, some of the church were so deceived that they were actually using scripture and they were using the ideas of God and twisting them to try to actually prop up slavery, which is crazy. But for the most part, since Jesus came on the scene, freedom and the end of slavery, we've been marching, getting better and better and better and better and better at it. And the teachings of Christianity are at the core of that. That's the bottom line. It's at the core of that. Another example of this would be infanticide. So ancient cultures, it was totally normal to kill babies. Totally normal. Romans were known for this, but there were other cultures that did the same thing. They called it exposure. So they thought that it was good for the culture. Like, if you had a child that you didn't want, you would just go expose them to the elements. You would go leave that baby in a forest, or you would go leave them by the bank of a river, and you would let the fates decide of what was going to happen to that child, which, you know, duh, the kid's going to die. You're not leaving anything to fate. You're just, you're cleansing yourself of something. So people, it wasn't a prosecutable offense in the Roman Empire, which actually had a very strict set of rules. They ruled with law and order, and yet that wasn't a prosecutable offense. And so you had all these people who would have a child that they had a girl, and boys were prized higher than girls in ancient cultures. And so you had a girl and you didn't want a girl, and you would just go expose her. You thought maybe your wife, there was some infidelity, and you weren't sure that that child was actually yours. And so when the child was born, you would just expose that child, go leave that child in the woods. If a child was born with birth defects, you would just expose the child. You didn't want to have to deal with that. You don't have to deal with that, right? Well, along comes the teachings of Jesus, and along comes Christianity, and the people of God in the Roman Empire. As Christianity spread through the Roman Empire, Christians were seeing what was going on, and the folly and the error of the culture around them compared to the kingdom of God. And so they began not only critiquing what was going on in the Roman Empire, but they did something about it. Christians began scouring the woods and the riverbanks. They began searching out to find babies that were left in different places, and they would pick them up, and even though they were poor and had limited resources, they would take those children home and they would raise them as their own. Okay? This is yeast working its way through the dough of the culture. And do you know what happened? It took time. But what ended up happening is the action of the Christians, the way they lived their lives, actually had such a profound effect in awakening the moral conscience of the Roman Empire that in AD 374, Emperor Valentine outlawed exposure. It was a prosecutable offense. You could be held to that standard. It was no longer legal for you to do that. All because Christians engaged in patient ferment, living out the kingdom values. Okay? You could go, like, we could also talk about the rights of women. And I would say the church has been at the forefront of advocating for the rights of women up until a certain point. And we've kind of done a bad job of closing the last gap of equality that's maybe missing. But most of women's rights that have been advocated for, the church has been at the heart of that. The teaching of Jesus has been at the heart of that. We've talked about that before, that Jesus gave power and authority, and the church gave power and authority to women in ways that had not been done in the ancient culture. And it set humanity on a different course than what we were on as a result of it, okay? Here's the deal. So we find ourselves looking at a scripture like Galatians chapter 3, verse 28, where Paul writes, at the time, these were scandalous truths. Like, scandalous stuff. Now we read it and we're like, well, I mean, yeah, that's the way it should be. Because our conscience has been informed by the politics of the kingdom of God, Okay? So Paul writes in Galatians 3:28, there is neither Jew nor Gentile. The dividing line between not just different nations and different tribes of people, he's actually drawing a line of distinction between the Jews, who were known as the people of God, and the Gentiles, who were the people who were not the people of God, right? He's like, that dividing line is not there anymore. Neither slave nor free. And we're like, yeah, absolutely. Ancient culture would have been like, whoa, 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 whoa. What are you talking about here? Like, you're saying there's no difference between me and my indentured servant, that I should be treated like they're being treated and they should be treated like I'm being treated? Total and complete flipping everything on its head. Nor is there male and female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus. This is the politics of the kingdom of God and the patient ferment of living out these truths has deep and lasting impact if we'll engage the way that God wants us to engage. But the problem is we overestimate what political, earthly politics, what political solutions can accomplish. And we underestimate what can be accomplished when the people of God embody the kingdom of God in the world around them. And we fight, and we scratch, and we claw because we feel like we should be getting more traction. And maybe if we do these things that make more sense to our minds, we'll get that traction. And then Jesus will be seen for who he really is. Has the church ever been, like in the United States, has the church ever been more political than it has been in the last 50 years? I don't know, because I'm not that old. But from what I can understand, no. I don't know that we're necessarily more political, but we're certainly not less political than we have been before. And yet, does our culture recognize the goodness of the kingdom of God through what they see in Christianity more today or less today? I would argue less. And I would argue that a lot of it has, some of it has to do with the gospel's offensive. The kingdom of God being upside down, it is offensive. It is offensive. And God's standard, it is offensive to people. So some of it is that. I'll acknowledge that. But I think a lot of the disdain that people have, it has more to do with the fact that we've gotten caught up in the machinery of the world around us rather than being different. So there was an article written in 2016 by Jonathan Lehman right after the 2016 election. And he basically just said, like, I know some of you are in a puddle on the floor. You're so upset over who got elected. Some of you are, like, partying. You're so pumped over who got elected. And then I want to read just a little bit of what he says. He pivots really hard. And he says, more than anybody then, it's high time for Christians and churches to turn our heads from the national news and focus our attention back to where the real political action occurs. It's not in Washington. And it's not through a quadrennial affair. No, it's a daily affair. And it occurs in and through our church bodies. Every day of our lives, we are ambassadors of heaven. We go out as ambassadors with a political message. The king offers pardon for every rebel who would repent. Every day, our churches should exemplify for the nations divine righteousness, justice, and love. And then he says, Paul, the Apostle Paul writing, asked the Jews of his day, you who preach against stealing, do you steal? Asking a question. You're advocating for one position about something, but are you living in a way that's congruent with what you are advocating for? And then this author says, I've got a few questions of my own. And I'm going to read you these questions, okay? And here's the deal. I'm not trying to zing. The point is not for us to feel bad. The point is for us to go, okay, if I'm advocating for a certain political position, but I'm not living out my life, it's not that we shouldn't advocate for a political position. That's okay. But if we don't understand that our lives are meant to be the yeast of the kingdom of God working its way through the culture, and that is the number one thing we should be obsessing over, there's a problem if there's incongruence between what we advocate for, what we vote for, what we politic for, and what we actually live out in our own life. So the goal in asking these questions, again, not to zing, not to make us feel bad, it's just to ask honest questions, to go, okay, hold on a second. How am I living my life, all right? So you who call for immigration reform, do you practice hospitality with strangers? You who vote for family values, do you honor your parents and love your spouse self-sacrificially? You who speak against abortion, do you physically and emotionally defraud your girlfriend? Do you let worldly ambition delay having children? Do you never make it home in time for the soccer game? Or do you embrace and assist the single mothers in your church? Do you encourage adoption? You who talk about welfare reform, do you give to the needy in your own congregation? You who proclaim that all lives matter, who are your friends? Do they all look like you? You who lament structural injustices, do you work against them in your own congregation? Do you rejoice with those who rejoice and weep with those who weep? You who fight for traditional marriage, do you mutually submit to your husband or wife? Husbands cherishing wives as you would your own body, and wives respecting husbands in honor. You who are concerned about the economy and the job market, do you obey your boss with a sincere heart, not as a people pleaser, but as you would obey Christ? You who care about corporate tax rates, how do you treat your employees? Do you threaten them, forgetting that he who is both their master and yours is in heaven and that there is no partiality with him? You who opine on social media, do you gladly share the Lord's Supper with the church member who disagrees? Do you pray for their spiritual good? See, 1 Corinthians 4:20 says, "For the kingdom of God is not a matter of talk, but of power." And I always read that and just sort of thought in terms of like spiritual power, like to perform the miraculous. And we do have spiritual power to perform miraculous. God moves in supernatural ways. He can bring supernatural healing. He has power over and against the powers and the authorities of this world and of our enemy, the accuser. Like, that's reality, okay? But the bottom line is that this verse is not just talking about that kind of power. In fact, in other translations, it unpacks that a little bit more. The Message translation says, God's way is not a matter of mere talk. It's an empowered life. The kingdom of God is the power not just to do miracles, but it's the power to be a miracle in the world around us. God can empower your life to be a miracle, and not just individually, but communally, that we can be a community of the miraculous in the world around us, that we can live in a way that perplexes the world around us, that brings into contrast the difference between the kingdom of God and the kingdom of the world. And I think sometimes we get so caught up in our own personal following Jesus, and we miss, again, it's not an either or, it's a both and. Like, our relationship with Jesus is personal, but it's also communal. And when you look at the ethic of Jesus, it's incredibly difficult to, like, I read the Sermon on the Mount, the teachings of Jesus, and it is unnerving to read those, because the way of Jesus is so much higher and the standard is so much greater than anything I could ever achieve on my own. And so thank God he can not only empower me to do that, but he puts me in a community of other believers that together we can encourage one another and hold each other accountable and spur each other on to better works than we could ever do on our own. This is who we're called to be. The kingdom of God, it's not about mere talk. It's about an empowered way of life together. So I want to close by reading to you a story about Dietrich Bonhoeffer. Dietrich Bonhoeffer was a theologian, an author, a pastor, back at the rise of the Third Reich during Nazi Germany. And Dietrich Bonhoeffer saw what was going on with the Nazi rise. And he saw the way that the church was caving in and bowing its knee to the Nazi regime. And he knew that something needed to change. And so he actually set up a seminary that was out in the country. It was called Finkenwald, was the name of the property. And it was all these followers of Jesus came together, and they were intentional about pressing into the ways of Jesus. They were intentional about wrestling through what would it look like in our time right now. What would it look like for us to live out the ethic of Jesus in the culture that we live in now? And he had all kinds of friends, and word was getting out about the work they were doing in this seminary at Finkenwald. And people were hearing the sermons that were being preached, and they were like, this is, like, they seem really out there. They seem kind of crazy in the middle of everything that was going on. And so one of his friends actually had kind of heard that maybe they were getting a little too spiritual, where they weren't going to be any earthly good, is what his concern was. And so he went out to go visit Bonhoeffer and to check in on him. And I want to read you an account of that story and some thoughts. When Bonhoeffer's friends began to read copies of his sermons and hear reports about the intensity of the discipleship at Finkenwald, questions began to arise. Was this level of spiritual formation truly necessary? Would they burn out? Would they lose credibility and be seen as too extreme by the national leadership? One friend in particular, a young historian named Wilhelm Niesel, who had heard Bonhoeffer lecture in 1933, came up from Berlin to visit, being suspicious of too much spiritualism. Bonhoeffer took Niesel on a rowing trip to the Oder Sound. One author described the scene this way. When the two rowers reached the far shore, Bonhoeffer led Niesel up a small hill to a clearing from which they could see in the distance a vast field and the runways of a nearby Nazi squadron. German fighter planes were taking off and landing, and soldiers moved hurriedly in purposeful patterns like so many ants. And Bonhoeffer spoke of a new generation of Germans in training whose disciplines were formed for a kingdom of hardness and cruelty. It would be necessary, he explained, to propose a superior discipline if the Nazis were to be defeated. You have to be stronger than those tormentors that you find everywhere today. Bonhoeffer, a pastor with unflinching loyalty to the cross, standing as a prophetic sign to the word, on the side of a river, overlooking the massing Nazi troops, he stood in the shadow of eternity, a man of convictions, a man of contrasts. What he was doing in Finkenwald had to be stronger than what Hitler was doing with his army. Discipleship must be stronger than cultural formation. Loyalty must be stronger than compromise. This must be stronger than that. The times called for a beautiful resistance. Such a prophetic stance was in some ways laughable. Bonhoeffer's seminary was small and its season was short. The Gestapo would close the seminary in 1937, just 4 years later. In many ways, it was a feeble joke compared with the power of the Third Reich. But it was a prophetic seed of a faithful church. And over time, as Jesus promised, that small seed grew and bore fruit. And today, the Reich is a shameful memory. Hitler is in the grave, and the German church is repentant. But the fruit of Finkenwald, the community, the vision, and the work has gone on to shape the vision of Christian discipleship and inspired millions. Bonhoeffer was right. This must be stronger than that. And so this author says, I think about our cultural moment and the compromise rampant in our day. Should we just give up and capitulate to the power of our time? Should we sit by while our faith is taken captive by political and ideological forces? Should we avert our eyes while mammon wreaks havoc on our hearts? Should we watch as 20 million young people leave the church in our generation, 1 million a year give up on faith? And I ask these questions to us, CLF. Is it possible to build a community in such a way that though we are small, generations to come will look back on our faithfulness in a generation of compromise? Is it possible? Is it possible for us to be that kind of community that grabs the truth of the kingdom of God and allows God to teach us to be faithful in the patient ferment of the kingdom of God in the middle of the world that we find ourselves in. Will generations after us look back and find us faithful to Jesus and his ways? Let's pray. Let's ask him to shape us into those people. Heavenly Father, we come to you this morning. And we thank you for the truth of who you are, that your ways are not our ways, that your ways are higher than our ways. We thank you for the beauty of an upside-down kingdom, even as it's perplexing to us, and even as the patient ferment you call us to is maddeningly slow. God, we thank you for the beauty of your plan. And we thank you for the power of your Spirit that you fill us with, that we can walk out your purposes on this earth. God, give us wisdom. We don't know how to walk, and we don't know how to act, and we don't know what this means for the reality that we find ourselves in. Would you give us wisdom to know? Would you guide us every step of the way as we lovingly engage the world on behalf of you? In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Amen. I want to thank you for sticking with me. I know as I've gone longer than I usually do or than I should. Thanks for hanging with me on that. I want to give you just a couple, we've been giving you a couple practical things at the end of each message to help us in this season of chaos and confusion. So here's a couple practical tips this week, okay? The first one is listen 2 times as much as you speak. Have an internal audit of how much am I speaking versus how much am I listening, all right? Let's pay attention to what other people think, what other people are experiencing. That is the way of Jesus. The way of Jesus is entering into other people's experience, right? And I would encourage you, seek out brothers and sisters in Christ that think differently than you, that vote differently than you. Engage them in conversation, not to argue with them, but to listen, to hear where they're coming from and to hear their hearts, okay? The second thing is to ask, this could guide you in your social media engagement, but it could guide you in other ways too. Ask a question to learn instead of making a comment to teach. In this week, ask questions to learn rather than making comments to teach. And then the last piece is engaging in spiritual community. We need each other more than ever, and so I would encourage you, whether it's in a life group that you're already a part of or whether it's calling up a Christian friend of yours this week, to ask them, can we pray together to ask God to help us stay in step with what he's up to? Can we pray and ask God to help us keep our eyes fixed on the kingdom of God and not the kingdoms of this world? Can we ask God to keep the priorities of our heart in line, right? Like, let's do that. Let's be more intentional than maybe what we normally would be in this week. So pick one of those three. Do all three of them if you're an eager beaver, all right? But let's lean into this season and let's let God move in us and through us. Thanks for being here this morning. Love you guys. Hopefully we'll see you back next week.